I mean, my talk is going to be quite straight, you know, quite straightforward, quite short. As in, you know, I was struggling to see if I could show you a few cases. I don't have any. Which just goes to say whether the role of IR, how much is it actually in cirrhotics for with portal vein thrombosis. So with that brief idea in your mind, I'll just go through. What I've done is, I've done the presentation in a way which sort of is the way I think we should be thinking as to how to go ahead, whether we have to do something or not. So all of you know, I won't take much of your time. Overall prevalence of PVT cirrhotics is 25%. Sometimes you see them in asymptomatic patients when you do an ultrasound. You see about 4.4% of people tend to have portal vein thrombosis and they're completely asymptomatic. Similarly, a CT MRI prevalence that we see in our patients when we do follow-up CTs or MRs, we see about 10 to 12% of patients. And that's been you know, reiterated again and again in various studies all across the world. So one thing, you know, as an IR radiologist, what we need to understand is, I know our clinical colleagues give us a good amount of you know, clinical scenario of the patient. But we, for all those who are listening and who are the medical radiologists or an interventional radiologist in the audience, I do not know. But the effects of PVT, you know, how much, what are the effects on the outcomes of cirrhotic patients? So one need to understand to imbibe that importance as to how, you know, whether IR can actually help this patient. All of you know the meta-analysis by Stein, I think they looked at close to about three studies with the 2,436 patients, which the significant fatigue decompensation, ascites, and mortality. Again, Rodrigues, I think, looked at transplant patients, approximately 25,000 patients, which said 10.5% fatigue mortality and 18.8% of 1 year mortality for patients with PVT. A recent study, but a very small group, close to about 170 patients, sort of contradictorily said PVT is just a epiphenomenon or just a co-occurrence and not a predictor of advanced cirrhosis. But there were a lot of critics for that particular study, particularly because of the number of patients that were looked at. In any case, what we know is there's a rebalance of the hemostasis and cirrhotics, okay? There's a reduction of both procoagulants and anticoagulant factors. I mean, these are the various things that we need to, you know that whether whatever we are going to do is going to work or not. So what happens in progression of PVT? So if one of the hepatologists or the gastroenterologist or the transplant team comes and says, you know, what's going to happen to this patient? We know, all of us know, most of them have spontaneous resolution or unchanged appearance, irrespective of what is going on. I mean, that's been, I think this was published in the gastroenterology in 2016, which showed a spontaneous resolution of nearly about 70% and progression only about 7%. So as an IR radiologist, already that's a back foot for me. So I know even if I don't do anything, most of the patients will spontaneously resolve. So that's the first thing in my mind. And then obviously there's this famous article which was published in Gastroenterology in 2016, which gave sort of a very brief overview and this very useful flow chart. It said stable disease, just follow up, managing options to be discussed with the gastroenterologist and with the hematologist and the transplant surgeons. Progressive disease, you may consider anticoagulation plus or minus tips, and then eventually on to transplant and all the endoscopic work they can do for that. That again in chronic patients. Acute portal vein thrombosis, again they have said anticoagulation, slip tips slash surgical, but we'll come to that in a second. Now radiologically, again for us, before we decide as to what to do, you know, what our practice here is to classify. You do an anatomical and a functional classification of portal vein thrombosis. It is pretty straightforward, all this looks a bit complicated. The first one is actually, where is the thrombus based on the size or the extent? Is it occluded or non-occluded? Are there any symptoms? what is duration? And it's important, this duration is actually quite important, which is one thing which we give a lot of weightage to as IR radiologists. Acute, subacute, or chronic. It's very difficult. I mean, and there's another entity called acute and chronic. I'm forever confused with that term, honestly speaking. And how? What is involved? Splenic vein, mesenteric vein, or both? So again, so I'll just pause a bit on this slide. So this is the anatomic and functional classification. So the anatomic classification you can see basically on the right-hand side of the screen, you will see type 1, type 2, A, 2, B, depending upon where the thrombus is, that's a red color mark, and whether it's occlusive or non-occlusive. Functional depends on whether it's recent, which is actually quite a friendly term to be used. You can actually use acute and subacute under that umbrella term, recent. And then chronic. And what chronic means is maybe probably lasting more than a couple of months with other ancillary findings. So this is sort of the flowchart diagnostic workup or the pre-IR workup that we have in our mind before we decide to do anything. Okay, so then we have been referred this patient. Let's say we've been referred this patient. Ultrasound, everybody knows 100% sensitivity in complete PVT. We always do a contrast and CT or an MRI for anatomy, classification, and management plan. Okay, so coming to the very basis of the talk. Honestly, there are only just a few more slides to go through because the role of interventional radiology is there. It is important, but maybe not as extensive as in other subspecialties that where we use IR. So there was a prospective study, I think that was done, I can't remember exactly, but it was a prospective study done by Lucas, and it was published in 2016, of 70 patients. Now, in this 70 patients, the tips were done, and there was the results were complete recanalization in 57 patients, marked decrease in thrombosis in 30 patients, no improvement in 13% patients, 95% maintained patency for about 24 months, which is obviously quite a good number. That would be the case in TIPS even without PVT. And then complications similar to patients without PVT. So I mean, when that trial came out and it was published in the journals, that gave us a bit of a boost to do TIPS in these patients. But again, if you look at the article, if you look at the study, what all these patients were actually on anticoagulation, or they had a trial of anticoagulation, all these 70 patients. And in this, TIPS was done because the primary anticoagulation failed. So that is probably a good ladder to step on. So that's one thing which, as an IR radiologist or our IR team, is sort of imbibing. Okay, so there's a patient who's got PVT and has got failed anticoagulation. That's one tick box for IR to be involved. Okay, so based on that particular study, so I'm sort of four tips. We'll come to subsequent slides to explain a bit more. Okay, so we have done the tips post tips anticoagulation. I'm going through the slides as it is my thought process there. So if you're getting confused, please do stop me in between. Now, let's see, then post-tips. So what about post-tips anticoagulation? Now, there was an RCT done by Wang again over 2 years, 2016 to 2015-2017, which showed no additional benefit of anticoagulation post-tips. So if you established a good flowing tips with good pressure equilibrium in a patient with PVT, any anticoagulation has no additional benefit is what their study came out. So that sort of puts in a thought in your mind that PVT could be related to flow disturbances. And then there's the option of PVR tips. Okay, so when do we do this? What is PVR tips? I mean, so usually it's the most, it was Thornburg and colleagues back in 2016. They're based in Chicago, if I remember correctly. They published an article in JVAR, which is a final analysis of 64 patient cohorts in 2016. So they actually did a PVR TIPS procedure in chronic / extensive PVT. It was mainly to improve transplantation candidacy. Obviously, that was the main reason for them. So what you do in PVR TIPS is you get a transplenic access, put your catheter and wire into the splenic vein, which may or may not be thrombus. Most of the time it's thrombosed, and then go up the main portal vein, enter one of the intrahepatic portal radicals, and balloonplasty. So you are creating a lumen to do TIPS, and then you go on to do a TIPS. So in their particular study, of 64 patients, the median patient age was 58 years. The median pre-TIPS ML score was about 14, out of which, now in the 64, 56% had complete thrombosis. And following this, when they did the PVR TIPS procedure, the portal vein and TIPS patency was maintained to about 92%. And that was a follow-up period of 19 months. So just over 1.5 years, about 92% PV portal vein and TIPS stents were patent. And the recurrent PV/TIPS thrombosis was about an 8%. And this 8%, this recurrent PV and TIPS was, this 8% was in the people who had complete thrombosis. Again, that's a big, that's a good point to note. So again, very encouraging, result or analysis on this very small cohort, but, you know, fairly good follow-up for about 19 months, which is what. So remember, these patients are being sort of optimized for transplant. And they also, soon after that, published another article which also told about the technical consideration and the complications of PVR TIPS, which is fairly not too much. So we have talked about TIPS, we have talked about PVR TIPS, then let's talk about selective SMA thrombolysis versus TIPS. So towards, if you were to divide the western side of the world, the western countries, they tend to, they are more towards doing TIPS / PVR TIPS. Whereas towards the Far East, like in China and Japan, there's always a slightly more onus of doing selective SMA thrombolysis or procedures like DRTO. Now, selective SMA thrombolysis for patients with portal hypertension, there was a study done by Jiang and Gao, which is an RCT for 2 years. The follow-up was for 24 months, which is not bad. 40 patients were recruited, 50 had selective SMA thrombolysis, 50 had a TIPS procedure done. And the thrombolysis drug used was urokinase. And the primary outcome was change in portal vein patency, which was measured on CT / contrast ultrasound. What I do not know is, prior to the study, whether this patient was on any anticoagulation. What I'm not aware is what was the age of the portal vein thrombosis. Those are two things which I'm not aware of, I don't think it's mentioned in this particular study. Now, results of Jiang and Gao's RCT said that there's a symptomatic improvement in all patients within 48 hours, be it PVR or TIPS. So they all improved in 48 hours, which is pretty, pretty dramatic, actually, if you're looking at 40 patients. Then this PVT improved in 85% of the SMA group and 70% in the TIPS group. This is overall, we are talking about 24 months period. So there they showed that SMA thrombolysis with urokinase had a better result. And the main portal vein thrombus was significantly reduced in both groups across the 2 years. And in one particular, what was statistically significant was in the SMA thrombolysis group, the splenic vein and SMV thrombus significantly reduced compared to the TIPS alone group. That's in 24. So that is a particularly important inference from that RCT, where you start thinking as an IR or as a clinician or like yourselves, whether we have to seriously think about SMA thrombolysis in these patients. Now, what I think after going through all that, going through the studies, honestly, I had to go through a few literature to actually find out, to sort of have a cohesive thought process. And I'm actually quite glad that I'm giving this talk, because, till now I was equally confused as to what is the approach when Dr. Charles Frankel asked me, what is your approach in PVT in sclerotic? I was a bit taken aback. I'm not very sure. But then, giving this talk sort of made me a bit more confident. So I know actually what I need to do now. So what I think is, you may consider TIPS if this progressive PVT, despite satisfactory anticoagulation. So you have got a patient with PVT, you have started anticoagulation, but there's progressive PVT. It doesn't matter, it may be 1 or 2 months. It doesn't matter, but if it's progressing, then you may consider TIPS. Then PVT associated severe portal hypertension and related symptoms, you can consider TIPS. That's one thing that I think is probably in my sort of workup or plan for such patients. TIPS may not work in patients in chronic PVT with portal cavernoma. So you know you've got a chronically occluded portal vein, and you've got the parallel veins of Petron or Saint, and they form this portal cavernomas. See, as a lumen, so the problem is when you're trying to do a TIPS, you cannot see the luminal thrombus portal vein. It's not accessible for any catheter, or the cavernomatous vein is not amenable for dilatation when you come from the spleen. So in this case, TIPS may not work. So there's nothing much we can do for this patient. So patients as such, I just maybe take a step back and, you know, decide what else we can do. PVR TIPS, I think, is probably an upcoming specialty, upcoming procedure in extensive chronic PVT with main portal veins. So there is a target we have where we can access through atherosclerotic vein. So in extensive chronic PVT, wherein the patient is symptomatic and there is the anticoagulation is not working, PVR TIPS, I think, is a fantastic alternative. I know we need more RCTs. There are most recent studies in 2016. We need, the problem is getting these patients in for RCTs is going to be difficult, as you know. It's practically difficult to do, which is why you see not more than 60 to 100 patients in a particular study. So, yeah, we need more results for that. But PVR TIPS, I think, based on the various, reading that I've done and on the experience of many people, I think PVR TIPS is a good alternative. SMA thrombolysis, maybe case-to-case basis. When you're thinking of patient who's got an acute splenic vein and SMV and IMV thrombus, maybe SMA thrombolysis with something like alteplase, which is fairly safe, can be contemplated. But that has to be strictly on a case-to-case basis. So that's sort of my slide for my thought process for patients with PVT, PVT in cirrhotics. So, I mean, again, so multiple references which I have copy of, which I can email you guys. So nothing much else to say, guys, that I've done here. But the most important take-home slide for me and for what I need to pass on to you guys, if you all agree, is this particular slide. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rohit.
Not at all.
I'm very glad to hear that you share our pain with regards to confusing terminology. Because,
yeah.
And most important, the applications of this computing terminology. So,
yeah.
The biggest obvious challenge is that this terminology has implications to the success of your recanalization significantly, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
If you did have a person who came to you suddenly de novo with just a portal vein thrombosis without any clear evidence of sort of longevity, then what would be your thought process about recanalization? That's number one. Or the TIPS. And secondly, would the process change at all? Because one thing that you have not mentioned in your presentations is what was the severity of the disease? I'm presuming that most of it was child's A or early B. Would that make any difference to your sort of plan?
Yes. So to answer your first question, so in a patient who's come to, let's say, who's come to us with the PVT of unknown age, and if he's symptomatic and he's on anticoagulation, so if the previous images show that there is pre-existing thrombus and that's extended, I would definitely consider a TIPS in this patient. That's for sure. Now, the most important thing is this patient a transplant candidate? But that's the most important thing, you know, because where we place the stent, you know, do no harm to the main portal vein. Because every time you put a catheter in all these portal veins, it creates intimal injury. It creates intimal injury. It is always a site of thrombus post-transplant. So you know, have to consider all that into factors. So if your patient is a good candidate for a transplant, obviously, and he's particularly stable with anticoagulation, with not much symptoms, I wouldn't do TIPS. But if the other way, the patient is symptomatic, and the thrombus is progressed despite anticoagulation, I would consider TIPS. And the second question, remind me, Dr. Sola, what is the second question again?
So the second question was, what's your thought about the degree of liver disease, really?
Yes, correct. Yeah. So in all the articles that I've read, the success of TIPS has always been in child A or B patients.
Okay.
The results of child C patients following TIPS are not very great. And there is no statistical benefit whatsoever after following TIPS. Yeah, in PVT with cirrhotics, not talking about the bleeding or I'm talking about PVT in cirrhotics. There's no statistical improvement or difference in patients with more than child B. A MELD score average of about, you're talking about 12 to 15, is where the results have been good for TIPS with PVT in cirrhotics.
Sure. And just one quick follow-up question on that. Suppose you had a patient who comes with PVT and who is extensively collateralized, you know, and then you found that the pressure gradient was not substantial.
Yeah.
Do you have a pressure gradient cutoff for deciding whether or not to go ahead with the TIPS in a situation with PVT, especially in view of the extensive collateralization if it exists?
Yeah, so in what we see in this, mainly the extensive collateralization in portal cavernomas, it's funny that we don't see that much of a pressure gradient at all in these patients. You know, it's a, if they're significantly collateralized and there's a lot of flow going around the main portal vein, there's not much of a difference. But if you're talking about when do we step in, you're talking about roughly a difference, a pressure gradient difference about 15 to 20.
Sure. Question from the floor was on from Dr. Pawan. Does the liver volume or size change decision on feasibility of TIPS? I think that's probably, regardless of the PVT, I think it won't. So.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, yes, liver volume and size. If you know, again, it's very important. Is this patient a patient for transplant or not? Because if it's a patient for transplant, what we really want to do is use the shortest stent possible and stay clear of the IVC if you can, or just get in the IVC. So if it's a huge liver, what you immediately end up having is a lot of liver to transverse from the right hepatic vein to the portal vein. So technically a bit difficult, and also we end up using a longer stent, which can be sometimes things can go wrong, and we can have the stent ending up in quite high up in the IVC. So yes, liver volume and liver size is an important predictor of the feasibility of TIPS.
Okay. Uli, you had a question?
Yeah. Rohit, great talk.
Hi.
So one question, you talked about intervening when the coagulation fails.
Correct.
Do you have any definition of when you say it's anticoagulation failure?
Correct. Yeah. So the definition of anticoagulation, there's no time period definition for anticoagulation, you know, because I was expecting this question from the floor earlier, is it anticoagulation failed after 2 months, 3 months, 4 months? No, there's no time period definition, but the worsening of liver functions, persistent of symptoms which a patient came with, and non-resolution of the thrombus is what is deemed as anticoagulation failure.
And just one more question. You know, we used to have been with us for a long time. And whenever we have similar cases, he would look at a CT, look at the thrombus and say...
Sorry, I missed that bit, Oli. What did you say?
No. We've been with the for a long time with us in India.
Yeah.
So whenever we have a CT of these patients, he would always look at a thrombus and say, well, there's one area which is lighting up, looks very acute, let's thrombolyze do an intervention. He might have good results. So... is there anything radiologically you say that these patients are likely to benefit from intervention?
I think Vipin maybe is thinking of using it on acute / worsening between acute and chronic sort of thrombus. The likelihood, obviously, it's much better in acute thrombosis doing procedures. Now, how do you differentiate that on ultrasound? Simple. So if it's an acute thrombus in the portal vein, you know, it will be hypoechoic, it will be more darker, and the vein will be a bit distended. Same thing on CT, it will be distended and be more darker. Okay, and if it's chronic, it'll be more echogenic because there may be a bit of calcification, a bit of fibrous tissue in the thrombus, and it will be actually ectotic. The portal vein will be actually smaller. So when you look at it, you know, if it's acute thrombus, there is a lot of push for thrombolysis because it's the best chance to do thrombectomy, thrombolysis, and acute thrombus. That always is the case in portal vein thrombosis. De novo portal vein thrombosis, not in cirrhotics. In any portal vein thrombosis, if it's acute, the results are always better with when you do thrombolysis or percutaneous thrombectomy. But that doesn't hold true for the cirrhotics, as we can see from all the studies. Primary oral coagulation is the first best method in these patients.
Thank you.